How end-to-end encryption protects your messages and where it fails. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. A very simple question. What is end-to-end encryption? The phrase is something we hear often lately, whether it be the latest claims from a messaging app or some expose about how a particular conversation was exposed because it wasn't really end-to-end encrypted. The concept's getting a lot of press. Much of that press is exposing just how easy it is to either A, confuse, B, mislead, or C, both. Let's look at exactly what end-to-end encryption means. And the big spoiler here is that there's more than one definition. So first we need to talk about what encryption is. There are basically two types. Basic or symmetric encryption by itself is actually pretty straightforward. You take some data you want to protect, you choose a really large number, and then you scramble that data using that number with some very, very fancy math. The result is scrambled data that can't be unscrambled without knowing the large number you chose. That large number is what you and I might normally call a password or a passphrase or a key, but they all boil down to numbers inside your computer. Symmetric refers to the fact that you use the same large number to decrypt as you did to encrypt. Knowing that large number is what gets you access to all the data. Public key or asymmetric encryption refers to using a key pair, one to encrypt the data and then the other to decrypt it. Each key is just another large number, but they have this special relationship. Data that's encrypted by one can be decrypted only by the other. That's slightly more complicated. Using even fancier math, you generate a pair of these keys. You take some data that you want to protect, and then you scramble that data using one of the two keys. Once again, the result is scrambled data that can't be unscrambled, but this time it can't be unscrambled without knowing the other key. Knowing the other key is what gives you access to the data. Okay, end-to-end encryption. Type 1. What I refer to as the proper and pedantic definition of end-to-end encryption is simply this. Only the individuals at either end of the communication can view the communication. A very simple example is that I might encrypt a file with a password and then share that file and password with you. Only you know the password, and thus, in theory, only you can decrypt the file. This requires, of course, that I somehow tell you the password first, ideally using a different communications path so that the password isn't right there with the encrypted data for anyone to see. A more common scenario for messaging is that I, or the tools we use, share with you one of a pair of asymmetric encryption keys. I have the other. I then use that other to encrypt a message that only you can decrypt because you have the matching key. This tends to be more common for communications tools because the tools can handle all of this completely transparently without our having to decide on or mutually share some kind of password. In either case, it doesn't matter how the message gets from point A to point B. It's impossible to examine it along the way. It remains securely encrypted from one end of the conversation to the other end, you. Hence, end to end. Now, there is one risk, key compromise. If the key I give you, either the password in the first example or the first key of a pair in the second example, somehow lands in the hands of someone else, they then too have the ability to decrypt and examine the messages I might send to you. All right, end to end encryption, type 2. Now, in the companion article, I put this in quotes, end-to-end, because it isn't really end-to-end encryption. The problem is that some messaging services will claim that it is. And in a way, I can kind of see their interpretation. I just think it's wrong. Many services act as a middleman for your communications. Rather than sending your message directly from you to the person you're talking to, it'll go to the service where it's relayed to the destination. Either of two approaches can happen. The message you send is encrypted, sent to the service where it's relayed directly to the destination. Or the message you send is encrypted, sent to the service where it's decrypted, re-encrypted, and then relayed on to the destination. Now, that first scenario, that's still true end-to-end encryption. The second is not. Now, messaging services may claim that the second is still end-to-end encryption because your message never travels across the internet in unencrypted form. It's always encrypted and is thus safe from snooping from anyone except the service itself. Now, there are valid reasons that the second one might happen. For example, group chats are extremely complex to set up, fully end-to-end encrypted. Not impossible, just really hard. By using the second style natively, the messaging app only needs to manage its encrypted connection with the service, rather than trying to manage an entire mesh of encrypted communications. But as you might expect, some services are less than clear about which approach it is they're using. Now, why does all this even matter? And honestly, for most of us, it probably doesn't. As I say many times, you and I, we're just not that interesting. However, if you are interesting, or even if you just think you are, here's the risk. You're trusting the app. You're trusting the middleman. Specifically, you're trusting that the middleman isn't examining your data for reasons of their own. You're trusting that the middleman isn't handing over your information to other third parties. You're trusting that the middleman isn't handing over your information to, say, the government. You get the idea. If the middleman does that decrypt, re-encrypt thing in the middle, it has access to your unencrypted conversation, and you're trusting that they won't abuse that access. Even if they're trustworthy, though, they might be required to respond to, say, government requests. Since they have access to the unencrypted conversations, they're able to, and perhaps even required, to hand them over if so asked. If, on the other hand, the conversation is truly end-to-end encrypted, even acting as a middleman, they're only passing on encrypted data that they themselves can't decrypt and can't see. Thus, they don't have access to your conversations. Even if they get asked, they don't have anything that they can hand over. Now, there is one, I'll call it a fly in the ointment, and this is one that many people seem very eager to point out. End-to-end encryption is not absolute security. It removes the concern of anyone intercepting your communications as they travel across the internet from your device to that of whomever you're talking to. Intercepted data is only so much noise that can't be understood if it's truly end-to-end encrypted. That's great, but that leaves your devices as the next point of vulnerability. If your device is compromised, then even though a message might be securely transmitted to or from that device, while on the device, it can be captured. I mean, it has to be decrypted in order for you to create it or even read it. And a compromised system could capture it then before it's encrypted on the way out or after it's decrypted on the way in. Honestly, the same is true for the messaging app you use. By definition, it can see your messages, so that by definition, you're trusting it not to share those messages outside of your conversation. Now, this part has little to do with end-to-end encryption, but rather making sure not to assume that's all you need. You must keep your device secure as well. Now, like I said, for most folks, this is not something you really need to worry about. It's interesting, but not something I think you really need to act on. However, if you are one of those interesting people, be it a government gadfly, an investigative reporter, a political organizer, or something similar, then understanding how best to communicate is critical. In some cases, it can even be a matter of life and death. Visit the EFF's Surveillance Self-Defense site for guides on the tools and behaviors you need to consider for your specific situation. There's a link to that, as well as links to other related topics, updates, and more at askleo.com/180943. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.